Hey y'all, my name is Andy Wingo. It's a real pleasure to be here, thank you. And I'm a compiler nerd, I have to say, right? It's a technical title, actually. I work for Egalia. It's a Spanish software consulting company that does mostly consulting around free software projects. And if you know our work, it would probably be because of our work on WebKit, right? It's difficult to count these things, but we're something like the third largest corporate contributor to the WebKit project. We work on ports for customers, integrations for device manufacturers and such. Am I still ready? Okay. Integrations for device manufacturers and things like that. And then I have been working on JavaScript Core for the last 6 months or so. Spent some time with V8, but I'm mostly going to focus on JavaScript Core. Oh yes, fun fact, Egalia is a worker-owned cooperative. If y'all are interested about such a strange project, come to me afterwards and, you know, ask me about the thing. But I'm not really a JavaScript programmer, right? I'm a schemer at heart. That's, you know, whoa, whatever, right? But it's been just real interesting getting in the thick of these JavaScript implementations. They're fascinating things, and I find them, you know, quite interesting. So this is going to be a talk about some things that I've learned about the various implementations. And it's going to focus on JavaScript Core because they don't do a very good job marketing, and I don't think anyone really understands how it works, right? So I figure it's a good, you know, time to take out some of these things. I have a feeling, my perspective is that, languages are essentially tribal, right? That's the thing that defines a language community, that, you know, you have a group and you have in and outside, and you have your respected elders and your tribe and such. And I come from, you know, this Lisp tribe, and one of our old bards was Peter Norvig. You might know him. He's director of research now at Google. 20 years ago, he wrote a book called Paradigms in Artificial Intelligence Programming. And the book has not held up as far as artificial intelligence goes, but I think it's quite interesting on the practice of programming and some efficiency concerns. And he did some retrospectives on this book 5 years after and 10 years after. He hasn't done a 20-year one yet that I'm aware of, but he extracted, you know, these lessons, and they're kind of cute. One of them, though, that really has stuck with me in all my programming stuff, be it, God forbid, even in C++, would be that there are four general techniques which you can use to speed up an algorithm, being caching, compiling, delaying computation, which sometimes we call laziness, and then he threw in this thing called indexing, because at that time, Lisp programmers like to use linked lists for everything, and he was saying, please use an array or some structure with better big O complexity. But, you know, we'll interpret it charitably in any case. And I'm going to use this, you know, statement from my tribe as a way to interpret what I have found in the JavaScript tribe. So one extreme example of this would be the inline cache phenomenon. So raise your hand if you know what an inline cache is already. You get a third of the room or so. So this is when you're a language implementation and you see like x plus y, like you have to do something, right? You have to add it at some point, right? But the question is, how exactly are you going to go about doing this? Well, for example, in V8 and more even than that in Dart, what you do is you don't do anything, right? You don't implement it at all until it's run for the first time. And then when it's first run, you see what types are flowing through that call site. You compile a version of this operation specific to the types for that call site, and you cache that code in a stub. So there are those three most important elements of Norvig's maxim there, sort of working together. And of course, this technique also applies to field accesses, you know, x dot y. And interestingly, in V8, the caches work as input to the optimizing compiler later. I'll talk a little bit more about that in a bit. But like I say, I'm going to focus on JavaScript Core, and specifically to the new tiered compilation model. I'm going to do the hand-raising thing again. So how many of you have heard the term DFG? DFG. You got very few. And I guess LLint, probably fewer. Oh, OK, some, though. Awesome. Great guy. So JavaScript Core works. It compiles your code to bytecode. And then the first time it runs it on cold code, it will interpret that bytecode. And then if that code warms up, it will compile those bytecodes into native code. And then if that code, JavaScript Core determines that it's hot, then it will optimize that compiled code and produce a version which is specific to the types flowing through that call site. And it's a speculative optimization, meaning it doesn't have to be general. Like, so the highest end, it can fail at some point. Say you're adding a bunch of integers and integers and integers, and suddenly you see like a floating point number. Of course, all numbers in JavaScript are floating point, but there's the common optimization that small integers are represented differently. At that point, you would fail the speculation, tier back down from tier 2 up to tier 1, and wait again and try some more. And I think, I'm sure many of you have heard Larry Wall, Perl creator, but right, he has the cardinal virtues of programmer being laziness, impatience, and hubris, and I think they correspond in this order, actually, to the LLM, the baseline JIT, and the DFG JIT. So the LLint is the lowest level of JavaScript's implementation, JavaScript core's implementation. And this is very, very new. It's maybe, it landed a month and a half ago or so. So I'm not surprised that y'all haven't heard of it. And I'm not surprised you haven't heard of the DFG either, because that's also quite recent. It's the new interpreter that gets the first pass at your code in JavaScript core. I need to give a bit of context, though, for you to understand how it's different than the old one. So I'm going to do a bit of a deep dive into the bytecode, the byte compiler, the old interpreter, and then I'll show the new one. And we're going to see a bit of C++ here, and I'm sorry. You know, I have to deal with it at work. I figure y'all got to suffer a little bit of it, you know, somehow for justice, I guess. So anyway, if you have JavaScript core, for example, you have downloaded a WebKit nightly and you find the JSC binary, which is tucked in there somewhere for the Mac platform, or you build JavaScript core yourself, you will end up with this binary called JSC, and that's the interpreter. When you run it with the dash E argument, it's going to dump anytime it creates bytecode. So if we have this, you know, lame function here, function foo, and you put it in, press enter, right? It's going to print out some bytecode that it emits. And the interesting thing is, like, where is the addition here? Here we're just, okay, the result of defining this thing is the undefined value, which is kind of a WAT thing as far as language goes. But, you know, where is the addition? So, like we said about laziness, JavaScript core and V8 and I assume SpiderMonkey and God knows what the other engines do, don't actually byte compile. They don't even parse your function until it's run for the first time. They simply check the syntax, right? So the function that's never called is essentially free. There are some, you know, overheads for that, but if you have a function that is never called, like you have a big jQuery library or something and you just don't call some of those things, they never get created. Like, they never get parsed. They never get compiled, neither to bytecode nor native code nor anything else. So once you call them for the first time, though, JavaScript core is going to go ahead and byte compile it, you know, parse it, byte compile it, and produce this output. Here we see we have three opcodes, right? We enter the function. We are going to add, and it's a what they call a register VM. So you these -8 and -9. That's going to reference arguments coming in, and the result is going to be put in R0, and then you're going to return from that function 0. I think it's fairly clear what this is. The question is, what is implementing these opcodes, right? That is the interpreter at the very base level. And the classic interpreter, Squirrelfish, how about that? Raise hands for Squirrelfish. We got many. But that's the name that's, you know, sort of stuck with you. I'm not sure if the other thing that you knew, JavaScript core, Squirrelfish, all these names got, you know, jumbled together marketing-wise. The name of the interpreter is JavaScript Core. It's been marketed under various names, and when in 2008 the byte compiler first came out, because before they had this tree-based interpreter, they called it Squirrelfish. So the classic interpreter now corresponds more or less to that release in 2008. And here we go with some C++. You don't need to, you know, understand this, but I just want to show the shape, right? So if you find interpreter.cpp when you download the source, and you should, I think it's quite interesting if you dig this sort of thing, you'll find op-add, right? You search for it, and we see at the beginning we're parsing out the registers like we had in the dump, and then there are two cases, right? One is a case for small integers that don't overflow, and the other is a more general case where we're calling out to a stub. Finally, we put both of those handle putting the result in the destination. We advance the program counter, and we go to the next instruction. And this is kind of interesting here. The next instruction is a macro defined at the top, and it's a computed go-to. You see the go-to star, right? The opcode actually stores the address of the label in the C++ function. It's kind of, you know, makes your head turn a little bit, and it makes the compiler's head turn a little bit as well, because this isn't—it's not standard C, it's not standard C++, and it's a form of higher-level flow control, and the compiler doesn't really know the C compiler, right? GCC, LLVM, doesn't really know what to do with this function, right? It doesn't know what things need to be in registers, what things can be spilled on the stack, what things can be thrown away, because all it sees is all the labels could branch to each other, and it doesn't—it can't do very good analysis, right? So what happened was, is this fellow, Philip Pislow, which I don't know how long he's been working at Apple, but he's been contributing to JavaScript core for about a year or so, rewrote the interpreter in assembly, right? I assume that's not a portrait. I've never actually seen it before. And the LLint is the new interpreter for JavaScript core. Instead of being implemented in C++, it's implemented in a domain-specific assembly language, and it's actually compiled to the native code with a custom Ruby macro assembler. So I think it's fair to say that JavaScript core is now implemented in Ruby. It happens beforehand. It's ahead of time. It's part of the build process for JavaScript core itself. And again, I'm going to show you this custom language sort of for shape. You know, if you're really into this, the slides will be up later. You can check it out. And obviously, it's in the source as well. At first, we see we're defining a dispatch macro. So this is a macro assembler that allows you to define macros in its own language. So your dogs, right? Dispatch, we're adding some number to the program counter, and then we're doing the computed go-to. But this is in assembly now. We dereference the opcode that is there and jump forward to the next label, effectively. And these, like LLint, op, init, lazy rec, that's the simplest opcode that's in the interpreter, basically, and I put it up there just to show it. There's a trace execution, which normally doesn't execute. We parse out the register that we're going to fill with an empty value for various internal purposes. We store the empty value in that slot, and then we dispatch on to the next opcode. And that's the entire implementation of that opcode. I can't show add, though, not in its entirety, because you get adding small integers with small integers, adding small integers with doubles, adding doubles with small integers, you know, and then strings, right? Because it's string append as well. And then other value of type things, and it gets a bit complicated. So what he did, as this complication has to be repeated for all of these different opcodes, like add, divide, and subtract, and all these things, he made a macro called binary op that gets passed two macros, right? Macro being passed two macros, one which is the integer operation, one is a double, and you see at the bottom that we're instantiating the binary op with two macros which are defined there anonymously, like lambda expressions. I know you're all with me, right? So this is your new JavaScript core. And the question is why, right? The low-level interpreter has a number of advantages over the old one. Not only, you know, can we select what's on the stack and what's in the register a bit better, we can select what's inline and what's not inline, which is something that's kind of difficult to do in C++. To get very fine control over, you know, the ordering of your instructions, that gets you better locality, which means you're missing on your instruction cache less. Since you're not spilling as much stuff on the stack, you know what you can throw away. The garbage collector doesn't hang on to as much garbage. It doesn't think some things which are dead are actually alive, and it's much easier to transfer to tier up from the low-level interpreter to the JIT, because it's the same calling convention, because we control the calling convention like you don't when you compile something in C++. And yes, OSR is this process of tiering up or down. You're on the stack in the middle of a computation, and you replace the code that's running the current computation from, you know, one tier to the other tier, on stack replacement. It's also quite complicated. If you Google for that, you'll find a blog post in which it blows my mind entirely. So it's much faster, is the thing. The initial statement was 200% is fast, or I don't know whether that means times two or times three or what. I don't really know. In reality, if you have a JIT, you're going to tear up on anything that's hot, and so it doesn't make that much of a performance gain on some benchmarks. But when you're just slinging lots of JavaScript, it's good to have like a fast, low-level thing where you just don't do very much. Again, delaying computation, right? And on the iOS, you have this restriction where you can't generate native code as an app, right? And this sort of thing really helps out in that context, I would imagine. You know, I don't have any inside Apple knowledge, right? But it seems pretty clear that's what the deal is. The other thing you can do is you can actually use the LLM to profile what values are flowing through your interpreter. And you can use this information as input to your optimizing compiler to say, oh, actually, I've never seen a negative zero in this portion of the computation. And you would be amazed. Like, how much work goes into proving that you'll never see a negative zero, because if you can, it's many more code cases, right? So if you can prove that you can't, or you can speculate that you can't because you haven't seen one, then you can do much better. Right, so that's tier zero, the low-level interpreter. Tier one would be what was called Squirrelfish Extreme, if anyone remembers this one. It's essentially, you take all those code segments I showed you, like those little labels, and instead of making the native machine jump back and forth in between those labels, you copy them out and serialize them. So the native machine pointer is advancing. You miss fewer branches. The branch predictions work better. You can do some small optimizations here as well. And this JIT, until the LLM was implemented, was also the sort of standard for execution of all JavaScript. It's generic, it handles all the cases, and it's okay. The advantage, of course, is that you also control the stack as opposed to the old interpreter. So it helps you when you can tier up to the optimizing compiler after that. All right, no, C++, right? We're back. We're not, you know, crazy macro land. Again, I just want to show you the shape here. We're parsing out the arguments in the beginning, just as we were doing in the other interpreters. It's operating on the bytecode. It's turning the bytecode into native code. And we have a few more, you know, if blocks. This means we have a few more cases that we can compile specially, meaning your code can go a bit faster if we can tell that you're adding a constant to a constant small number to a number, right? Then it can predict a bit better what you're going to have while still having to implement the slow path. But in general, it doesn't have flow control. It doesn't know what's really happening in the function. So it can just guess. It has to be fast. It just slings out the native code. And then if you actually need it, the DFG is there. DFG stands for Data Flow Graph. And it refers to how the type information propagates in the optimizing compiler. This is for JavaScript core what the higher levels of Hotspot or what Crankshaft is for V8, like this is that, right? This is the optimizing compiler that tries to, you know, spend a bit more time on your hot code and use the type feedback to unbox your numbers, to define your functions, to, what else did I say here? Native arithmetic and object access and allocate your registers and all the things. In order to be able to do this, you need a couple of things. You need to be able to tier down, which is this OSR thing. And you couldn't tier down to the interpreter before because you didn't control the layout of the stack. But now with the LLM, you can tier between all these different levels. You also need profiling information about, you know, is this thing that is a plus in the JavaScript source code, is it operating on numbers? And if it's numbers, are they doubles or are they, you know, small integers or what can I do? And you need the ability to sort of abort when your speculation fails. It's kind of cool, and Crankshaft is cool in the same way, that you can just try really hard to emit the correct code. Like, assume that things are going to work out. And if things don't, if you see that negative zero, then you bail, and things go on with the older JIT. And it doesn't go as fast, but maybe it's your fault anyway. I don't know. That's a DFG. This is even more abstract, but I want to point out a couple of points here, and it's this word should, right? Before in the baseline JIT, we didn't know whether we, you know, should speculate for an integer or should speculate for a double or should only go the slow path of string concatenation or what have you. But in the DFG, we've actually done some flow analysis. We've eliminated dead code. We've propagated types around. And so we can, you know, have an answer for this should. What should I do, right? And that's what the DFG is able to do. And as far as combinatorics go, in JavaScript core now, there is the classic interpreter, still there. There is the low-level interpreter. There is the baseline JIT. And there is the DFG JIT. And they can exist in various combinations. And it depends on the port as to what actually exists. On the Mac, on x86, 32, and 64, and on ARMv7, you get the combination LLint, baseline JIT, and DFG. This is really what you want. A lot of the other ports, like I work on the GTK port, for example, it hasn't caught up yet. It needs a bit of platform-level support, and only have like the baseline JIT and the DFG. That's what's on GTK right now. And JIT isn't implemented at all on Windows 64, for example, so you just get the classic interpreter. But it's kind of nice that you actually have a portable interpreter to run things on, you know, even if you're on some strange platform like Windows 64. Yeah. So, again, back to Norvig's four ways to speed up the algorithm: caching, compiling, delaying computation, and, you know, if we're charitable, we're still including indexing. I feel like we're missing something, you know, because this is what Norvig was writing about in 1992 on big list machines, and some things are available to us now that were not available to him then. Specifically, concurrency. And, you know, how can we, you know, bring concurrency to bear on the problem of making JavaScript implementations faster? And what JavaScript Core has been doing is to parallelize what's called the mark phase of garbage collection. So garbage collection goes, you allocate, you allocate, you allocate, and at some point, there's no more free memory, right? So you stop, you mark all the live data, all the data which gets freed is swept, and you continue. And this marking phase stops your application, right? So if you have something that's trying to update at 30 frames a second or, you know, even more, it's very possible to get a pause of more than, you know, 50 milliseconds or something like that. So again, Philip Pislow, I hope to meet him one day because he sounds really awesome, parallelized this mark phase so it can use four cores, up to four cores. It can use more, but this is the current chip value, to cut your pause times down in the garbage collector. Right. And I think coming to the end here. Finally, so this is the number. Norvig, in his paid book, has this chapter 9 called On Efficiency. And if you substitute Lisp for, yeah, I just lisped. If you substitute Lisp for JavaScript when you're reading this, if you check it out from your library or pirate library or what have you, then it's quite relevant, you know, to modern day programming in JavaScript and in JavaScript implementations. And one of the things he says is that the expert Lisp programmer eventually develops a good efficiency model. You know, what is the cost of what I'm doing? There's a quote by Alan Perlis that a Lisp programmer knows the value of everything but the cost of nothing, right? But the thing is that this efficiency model changes over time, right? The things that are fast now in JavaScript, I was talking to a fellow yesterday, he's like, well, you know, if you just do this for x equals 1, x is less than n, you know, do something on my array, that's much faster than array for each. Well, why is this? It's because, you know, the benchmarks don't have array for each, right? JavaScript implementations are completely driven by benchmarks. You as programmers are in this loop, right? If there's a way that you want to program that's not working, you can file bug reports or create benchmark suites or such and get it to a point where it is fast. Like, this efficiency model can change over time, and don't let, you know, what's currently fast or slow crimp your style, you know, so to speak. And I think that's it. We can do some questions. You can find me this address or at that website. So thank you very much.